I'm very happy to welcome Phil Howell speaking to us tonight, and you obviously all know what he's going to speak to you about. Phil is was a student here at Emmanuel. He's now a fellow here at Emmanuel. I'm not sure what that means, but he went away.
I just think of it like promotion from the UT.
Maybe it's good to start as a student in Emmanuel. Yeah. Historical geographer, does that mean you're in history or you're in geography?
I'm in geography. My history colleagues, if they like what I do and it's not a given, they'll think, oh, he's just a historian. If they don't like what I do, I'm a geographer.
Historical geography. And then you moved from there, obviously, naturally, to prostitution. Not like geography or history, as I knew it. And you've written a book published in 2009, I think by CUP, the Geographics of Regulation, Policing Prostitution in the 19th Century, Britain and the Empire. And I think that'd be really interesting, so think about the Empire. You can go from all the way to the Empire, that is. And more recently, I know that you've moved from prostitution.
Please.
Can't hear. More
We're
recently.
All the way back here.
More recently, you've moved from prostitution to dogs. Victorian dogs. Domesticated dogs. Dogs in Victorian England. So that's a talk for next year, perhaps at the same time. You will want an entertaining evening in January 2018. I don't know. But tonight, anyway, it's about prostitution in Victorian Cambridge, and hopefully focusing on this area and Barnwell.
Thank you very much. I don't have the loudest voice in the world, but not bad. The last academic seminar I gave, I think there were four people. So this is quite nice. But if you can't hear me, then just don't just look disgruntled. Pop your hand up, and I'll try my best.
Okay, so
I can't do PowerPoint and read things at the same time. So I just essentially speak to the screen, which some of you can see it, some of you can't. But I'll try and fill it in as best I can. And thank you for the introduction. I wonder why I'm not richer, really. Sexuality, prostitution should sell. Dogs, I'm always told. I gave a talk on dogs in London not so long ago, and I wasn't really sure, it was a public talk, I wasn't really sure what people would ask me in terms of public questions rather than academic questions. And I guessed that somebody would ask me whether I have a dog myself. And so I had a little bit of time to work out a line, which is that basically I've only written two books. One on prostitution, the other on dogs. I don't have a dog. Okay, that's good, laughter is good. And I wanted to check with Caro whether that was the title I actually... Was it the title? Good. So I will focus on Barnwell, not so much on Mill Road, but places like East Road, Wellington Street, Wellington Row is by some distance the most notorious street in Cambridge. I don't know whether it's actually a light industrial and offices now at the moment, so people aren't likely to have a house there. If your house does come up here as a suspected house or a brothel, that's just history. But I'll talk about that. I am a geographer, so there are some maps, obviously. But my justification really is threefold. The first and the most abstract is that I see what happens in Cambridge in the 19th century as a form of regulation or management of prostitution or sex work. And policing prostitution or policing sex work in this way tends to operate spatially. The most obvious sense is that you have a kind of red light district, sometimes official, as in some of the continental European countries, but sometimes relatively informal. It isn't an official red light district, and this is Barnwell. If Cambridge in the 19th century has a red light district, then Barnwell, loosely defined, is that district. And I'll try and explain how that concentration of a kind of prostitutional economy evolved, and why it has, in my view, the tacit acceptance by the university authorities. Some of you will know some of this story, of course. I know. So that's the first thing, spatial policing, really. That's where the geography entered into this, just in case you're worried. The second thing is that, like so many of you, I'm interested in the physical landscape, and that it gives me a great pleasure to walk around and to think about what still exists in the landscape, but also what is gone. Most of this landscape is gone. Most of this landscape is the Kite or the Grafton Centre. Most of it is gone, but not all. But I have an interest in that. And the third thing, I have an interest really in the what, if it were, you know, a straightforward academic seminar, I'd say moral geography. And some of the geographers or historians would sort of start yawning a bit because, you know, they're used to that sort of language. But really a sort of landscape of morality and the place of Barnwell in that landscape of morality in Cambridge. If I have the first slide, I have to do this all the time, but I love this particularly. I'm sorry you can't see it at the back, but I like, students tend to talk about the Cambridge bubble, right? And I don't know whether Anglia students do the same, but certainly University of Cambridge students talk about the bubble. So we're so far out of the bubble now. We're in what students call the real world. And they say it with a kind of appall. It might as well be the Amazonian rainforest as far as they're concerned. But I particularly liked this quotation. I'll read it out. It's from something called the Urban Dictionary. The Cambridge bubble is the force field projected by the University Library Tower and has a radius that includes all university-owned sites in town and stops at the reality checkpoint, lamppost and Parker's Peak. The bubble's effect is to cut the students and staff of the university off from the real world. Outside events cannot break through the bubble. The bubble's distorting effects also affect, I think that's not my mistake, the bubble's distorting effects also affect students' ability to socialize, measure time, think logically, and can cause mental disturbance. All of you, all of us, will be familiar with reality checkpoint. Long may it illuminate over us. And of course, reality checkpoint is the boundary line between town and gown. That boundary is much fuzzier now with gentrification. I live on Great Eastern Street, so I'm not blaming anyone else for this, but rising house prices and the rest. But typically, that was seen as a marker between the respectable university and the relatively wealthy students there, and the working class districts of Eastern Cambridge, particularly after the enclosure of the Common Fields in 1807. Next slide, please. And thank you very much for your help. And this is just a map of Victorian Cambridge, quite late on because it doesn't have the borough jail, more or less where the YMCA and the swimming pool is now. But that's Victorian Cambridge. And next slide, or next bit. That, of course, is Barnwell. Barnwell was the village. A couple of miles out of, or not even from the centre of Cambridge, once a sort of sleepy, bucolic suburb, but with the expansion of the city or the town to the east, becomes engulfed in mixed housing. Some of it is relatively posh, looking at you, Cara and Richard, and some of it is houses for working people, particularly in Petersfield. And then off to Romsey, and the sort of leisure district on the way to Newmarket. So a district of theatres, a district of gaming houses, a district of pubs, but also a district of available women. And I'll have some more detailed maps in a second. But Barnwell is a place, but it's also a sort of neighbourhood of the mind. it's even a kind of brand, a brand that signals raciness and sexualized entertainment. And so Barnwell is the great contrast with the city of Cambridge. And if you stood at reality checkpoint and you stripped away successively a lot of the modern stuff, then you'd still have some sort of disciplinary institutions, some institutions that represent order and morality and the like. You'd have the church, at least from the 1890s. There is a servants' training institution, which is now the solicitors, just on the east side of Barker's Peace. Park House, I think it's called, or was called. But that was a servants' training institution, partly designed to give working women, or young women, you know, an opportunity to for a career that wasn't something that would lead them down the line to immorality. You'd have the borough jail, and not too far away in the next slide, of course, just off on the junction practically between Regent Street and St. Andrew's Street, opposite Tesco, mini Sainsbury's, as the students call it. But the spinning house, the old Hobson's workhouse, dates back to the 17th century. But by the time you get to the early 19th century, this is the university's private prison. It's a series of statutes that go back to the Middle Ages, but the university, in order to protect male undergraduates from either temptation or being preyed upon, in their mind, by the women of the town, by the early 19th century, the spinning house is only ever used as a locker for women who were suspected of plying their trade as quote-unquote common prostitutes, and it is a sort of legal term, it's not meant to be a term of abuse. But the spinning house is a central node in this sort of landscape of morality in the 19th century. Everyone would know about it, everyone would understand its place. Next slide, please. And I rather like, this is its place, that's what I started off with. And I did this research such a long time ago now, I can't quite remember the source of this marvelous image. I think it's the Cambridge Chronicle, it's the 1850s, something like that. But on the left-hand side, you have the Fountain Public House, now Novi. Anyway, it wasn't even in that exact spot, but the public house, and beneath it is written pleasure. Then you've got the old police station gates, and beneath those are law and order. Then you've got the spinning house, which represents morality in this schema, and the Baptist church representing religion. I've looked at this image so many times, it always delights me. And it always seems to me that it depends on the direction of travel. if you're heading out of town, this is bad. You start off in the church, you end up doing dodgy things, you get nicked, and you end up in the pub to drown your sorrow. The other way around, this is good. This is all perfectly above board. That's the route to heaven. But I like this image because it's not just about physical places. It's also about this sort of landscape of the mind that I was rather airily mentioning. The fact that it represents morality. It represents a certain intervention into the geographies of morality in the town. Next slide, please. I think this is probably going to be too detailed. But that's St. Andrew Street at the bottom, just as a plan of the old spinning house. And just behind it, Downing Place. I'm a geographer. The geography department is on Downing Place. Again, if I were trying to describe it to students, I'd say be behind Wetherspoons, behind Spoons. It did not occur to me many, many years ago just how very local this research would be. Geography department just a little bit to the left here, and the frontage on St. Andrew's Street. Next slide, please. And here are some photos of what it looks like. I think it was called a den of abomination.
God, it's horrific.
Gotta love the press. I think that was the Morning Chronicle, never in the 19th century, always a sort of campaigning paper. And in response to a series of scandals about the university arresting women of the town and making mistakes in their arresting respectable, quote-unquote, respectable women as prostitutes. The Morning Chronicle did a sort of expose piece, and they called it a den of abomination, or as here, a wretched, dirty, and ill-managed place. And that's what it looked like, some elements of the cells. Thanks very much. And these are the, we know, we have this information, which is a fantastic resource for the historian, if I'm allowed to be a historian, masquerading as one. If I'm allowed to be a historian, it's a fantastic resource because the university registered. They took down the name of the women who were arrested by the proctors. The proctors are the university, the fellows who are on a rota, charged with order and discipline in the university, mainly called upon now to police post-exam celebrations, which are way out of hand. But amongst their duties in the 19th century was to wander around the streets of Cambridge, looking out for university men doing what they shouldn't be doing, which could be gaming, it could be all sorts of things. But also they had the power to apprehend women of the town who they suspected of being prostitutes. The key thing, the really illiberal thing about it, was that you could be arrested not for what you were doing, but for whom you were presumed to be. That's always the sort of outrage, and some of you may know that the same concerns animate the Contagious Diseases Act, or the CD Acts in the 19th century, which in a number of naval and military towns allowed the Metropolitan Police to arrest women if they're suspected of being prostitutes, and to hold them, to medically detain them until such time as they were thought to be less, that the chances of them passing on venereal disease to the troops was reduced. We don't have anything quite like that here. But some of these women are examined medically, again, and that means genital examination by a spinning house surgeon, a university-appointed surgeon. That's probably not the majority of women here, and they probably aren't detained just until they're well, until they're not passing on or in danger of passing on disease to undergraduates. But they are, you still have the power of a private institution, the University of Cambridge, their proctors and their servants, who are called bulldogs, not the Victorian dog thing, but their servants are called bulldogs, and they have the power to arrest women and to bring them to the spinning house. And up to, 400 committals a year. Most of this really spikes in the 1840s, early 1850s, and really it's very quiescent in the second half of the 19th century, until actually the whole system falls into disrepute. There's a certain case involving a young woman called Daisy Hopkins. The university loses a big legal case, and essentially it's all over by 1894, and the building itself torn down in 1901. But that's what it looks like. And we have this information, it's all in the university library, these record books, these massive record books, which take down the women's names, their place of birth, their age, and the like. And it's a fantastic resource for sort of mapping out not just the history, the development of prostitution, but also the geography. I think if we go to the next slide. So it's about 70 years or so. I put this up there just because in the 1851 census, these are the women who, the 16 or so women who were in the 1851 census for the spinning house. Spinning house on the left, the names, the ages, unmarried, and the very blunt, you know, under the line in the census that is occupation, prostitute. It's not unusual, or it's not that unusual in the Victorian census. Sometimes you have no occupation, and that's a sort of euphemism. Sometimes just straightforwardly prostitute. Sometimes unfortunate, you know, makes its way into the census enumerator's lexicon. But they're here, and it's a kind of interesting snapshot. On that night of the census, these are the 16 women who are in the cells. Most of them in their late teens, of course, early 20s. There was a 29-year-old, Sarah Underwood. But that's on the night of the census, these are the women who are in, and their detail. Next one, please. I'll move on a little bit to speed up. Thank you. And it's a great resource historically, but it also speaks to the power of the institution, the power of the University of Cambridge over working people in the town, and more specifically over the young working women of the town. It's something that, rather like the Contagious Diseases Act, looks with hindsight astonishingly illiberal. But not just with hindsight. It's always important when people say, well, you know, standards or ideas change, and say you've got to put things in their own context. There were people who criticized this system at the time, one of whom was a guy called Charles Astor Bristed, who was a visiting American from New England, a little bit puritanical, but I think not astonishingly prudish. But he was disappointed in the standard of morality of the undergraduates that he was associating with. And he said about this system, this is called the proctorial system, he said that it might be no very violent exercise of its, the university's, almost despotic power in the town. I say almost despotic, for the town officers are sworn in by and subject to the university authorities, and the proctors have a right to enter any house or premises in or within a mile of Cambridge. It's almost despotic to put down all disorderly houses and expel from the place all the notorious prostitutes, of whom there are nearly 100 at the lowest estimate, as well known, he says, as if they were under a Parisian under a Parisian registration. Who's a local historian who doesn't like my link to regulationism, but there's evidence that at the time people were linking it to what was happening elsewhere. It isn't just a local story. It's also about the politics, or whether you can apprehend, take women from the street on suspicion, to examine them intimately, and to detain them at your pleasure. You know, it's the same kind of issues we might think of in some respects today. We go forward a bit. And I mentioned earlier that this is a kind of exercise in spatial policing. You can map out what happens here reasonably precisely. They don't always say why and what circumstances a woman is apprehended. But in the cases where they do, they have a kind of code. They talk about found street walking, which is straightforward enough, and found with gownsmen, which means that the woman was accompanying a university man. We're only talking about the university man. And here they are. And what the proctors tend to do, as you might imagine, I don't think it's a great shock, but what the proctors tended to do was to police the most public areas of Cambridge, the King's Parades, the Trinity streets of Cambridge. And they're arresting women that they thought were plying their trade in these areas. Occasionally picking girls or young women up with gownsmen in places like Parker's Peace or Jesus Green or Midsummer Common. They're there for purposes of sex. There's another historian called Janet Oswald who's done some work here who thinks it's unlikely that undergraduates would be taken from or would go to Barnwell, go to a street like Wellington Street, in order to have sex in a brothel or house there. It doesn't seem that far to me. But then I guess, you know, and it depends what time of the year and what the weather was like. But clearly in the darkness of Midsummer Common and Parker's Peace, things could go on. And the proctors were patrolling those areas. But you might contrast that with where these women said they lodged. There was no reason, I think, to disbelieve them. Most of the women are lodging in three areas, really. Sort of, again, as you can imagine, you know, it's reasonable to expect that they'd be slightly marginal. In the early 19th century, possibly in the 18th century, there are three areas, really. One is Castle End. St. Peter Street seems to be particularly prominent. The other is Newtown. And the other area is Barnwell, roughly understood. So everywhere from sort of Sun Street, Newmarket Road, Wellington Street, East Road, lots of places in the Kite area. And I've mapped them out for 1840 and 1850, and what I think is there is that a concentration over time, that where they were a little bit more scattered in 1840 and before, they're more concentrated in Barnwell, this single district, from the middle of the 19th century. It looks not just like a cluster of residences of working women. It starts looking more like a red light district. And the next slide, please. This is the map. I'm really not, I wish I had time to redraw. It's messy and it fails as a map in all sorts of ways, but I was trying to capture the movement over time and also to plot these places, which you could think of roughly as brothels. Not the kind of Parisian sort of brothel. What are they called? Maison Close. Not that kind of, sort of mega institution. These could just be houses where two women who plied their trade as prostitutes lived and perhaps took clients. They could be just lodges. But there are, looking through the university records, also looking through the newspapers and the police courts, you get a sense of houses which are particularly suspect, and the names and the numbers turn up time and time again. And what I did now many years ago was try to sort of plot those suspected houses, brothels in inverted commas. And again, they tend to cluster, and they cluster over time in these areas. I mentioned Wellington Street. I sometimes do a little walking tour for undergraduates, and every time I get to Newmarket Road, I think, oh, is it worth, you know, trawling off to Wellington Street? Because there's really very little to see. It has been so changed over the years that there's barely a whiff of the atmosphere of debauchery and immorality that if you were in the 19th century, if you said Wellington Street, Wellington Row, that would be perfectly understood what that meant. But there we are. We have it sort of clustered in those places. I've got till about quarter past one. Is that normal? Okay, I'll speed up. The rendezvous for hundreds of men and women who roll onwards and upwards to to the deepest atrocities. I don't think newspaper language has changed too much. And a spectacularly amazing controversialist called Robert Mackenzie Beverley. I looked him up on Wikipedia today, and he's described as a controversialist, which is a fantastic career. But he was a student at Trinity, but he was so disaffected with the university. He described the university as a prostitute mother, you know, a sort of weird sort of metaphor. This is admission season. I'm so used to reading below the line on any admission story and thinking, everyone hates us. I'm an admission student. Everyone hates us. But R.M. Beverley really hated the university. And he called Barnwell a town set apart and dedicated to sin, in a town wholly given over to fornication. He says about Barnwell, prostitutes swarm there, and Cambridge and Barnwell are, to all intents and purposes, one town. This is really important. He says that Cambridge and Barnwell merge, that Barnwell isn't just an immoral district, that actually Cambridge has a hand in the immorality that's produced, because for him and for others who critique the university, it is the male undergraduates who provide at least a portion of the demand for the sex economy that drives this. We go on, please. Love this image as well. I'm sorry, I shouldn't say love this image. You can't see it very well, but this image is of an undergraduate caught in flagrante, as they say, and it's titled rather wonderfully, quite unexpected. And the proctors are just walking in to see this this reckless undergraduate with a gaudy woman with an impressive décolletage on his lap. I'm probably not describing this quite as well as I should, but beautifully coloured, but quite unexpected. This is the proctor. The proctor's walking in and surprising this undergraduate with a woman in his rooms. If we go on, please. And I'm sorry, the next slides are a bit wordy. I might skip one, but I'll move on, actually. Thank you. R.M. Beverley, it's possibly my favourite quote in now too many years of academia. I still love it, even though it critiques the university, which pays my wages, and I love it. But this is what R.M. Beverley says about the university in 1833. Learning here is an accumulation of refined trifles. Mental exertion is rewarded with sloth, and gifts to the belly oppress the ardor of talent. Young men who come for instruction are too often infected with the general depravity and go away with a load of debt and the empty honor of a degree. Men of prayer are in imminent peril of backsliding, and repentant debauchees lapse into heresy. Fellowships are a temptation to a sinful celibacy, and religious tests encourage deceit and foster dissimulations. In one word, he goes on to say, he takes several, the university seems to be a slaughterhouse of conscience and a kingdom of evil. Wow, could it get any worse? That's what controversialists do in the 19th century. Not surprisingly, then and now, the university's defenders spring into action, not quite as efficiently as, say, sort of Putin's acolytes on the internet. It's important to them to say that actually, despite what Beverley says about Cambridge and Barnwell, they're distinct. One defender says that you, R.M. Beverley, say that Barnwell and Cambridge are to all intents and purposes the same town. If you mean mere contiguity or situation, you're right. But if you mean to convey the imputation that the former is therefore a common place of resort, the charge is as false as a charge can possibly be. Wow, really bad at it. It is scarcely it possible for two other places to be so near and yet so thoroughly distinct? The line of demarcation is widely drawn, and if you wish to know about what, I answer public opinion. In the great part of the society here, the name of the former Barnwell is interdicted. Next one, please. I think I'll just read one of these out. I'm sorry, I got a bit wordy. Another one says that university regulations, the whole proctorial system, is a breakwater against the high tide of temptation which sets in from Barnwell and the town, and the low tide which sets in from the previous bad habits and the full persons, or the good prospects of some of the young men. It's a breakwater. It's a defense, like the old King's Ditch or something. You know, it's a line that protects undergraduates as far as possible from their own viciousness, but also from the fact that they're preyed upon by women of the town. If you go to the next one, I think it's this sort of separation that seems to me interesting, and I read this geography as really part of a sort of tacit toleration of prostitution that goes on. It's impossible to police prostitution out of existence. Lots of police commissioners would say the same, I think. And actually concentrating at one spot, keeping it not central but relatively far out of the city, seems to me to be a compromise that they're happy with. It says you police the most flagrant prostitution, particularly street walkers on King's Parade, attracting custom, particularly the more temptable undergraduate. But you're always going to have those men who already have bad habits, vicious habits, and they're going to find women anyway. So if they're going to find women, have these houses a reasonable distance away. It is technically beyond their jurisdiction, but the town police are very much in cahoots with the university authorities. There's one of the mayors, a guy called Fawcett, R.M. Fawcett. I think he was the spinning house surgeon. He was a sponsor of the female refuge here, and was went a magistrate and went on to become one of the mayors of Cambridge. Not that difficult, you might imagine, for the vice chancellor to have a word with the police authorities and push them out. But these houses they know about, and I think they're just about far enough away to make it acceptable. Go on. I did have a quick look. I think I'll speed up a little bit. But of those women who were in the spinning house in 1851. I did some census work, and then I looked at my notes and realized I'd done them, also did this many years ago. But they tend to be, these are the women who are in the spinning house, 1851. Most of them have been there many times before, or are going to be in there many times again. Just one of them, I think, a woman called Julia Baden, just a single committal, this is it, when she's arrested by the proctors. Probably about half of the women who are arrested by the proctors only arrested that once. You know, so it's not a trawl of professional prostitutes by any means. And most are kept overnight and sent on their way, and probably don't undergo a medical examination either. But many of these women have been in and out of these institutions many times, at random. A woman called Isabella Garner, she's there in 1851, born in 1833 or thereabout, 19 committals in a 7-year period, 47 to 1854. She lived in 18, 19, 20, and 22 Wellington Road. She's described by the Cambridge Chronicle in their sort of mocking vernacular as a Barnwell lady. And the Cambridge Chronicle also say that she's known as Isabella Trender. Well, another of these women is known as Pinchon. Actually one of the difficulties in these records, many of these women presumably give false names or go by different names. It's not immediately apparent who they are. But most of these women, next one please, I think I'll move on fairly quickly. They've been there in the houses, in the spinning house many times, and they'll be arrested, and they turn up in the police court records as well. Another one, Martha Walsh, born 1830, 35 committals between 1846 and 51, lived in 18 Wellington Row, presumably the same house. Also lived on St. Peter Street, which is up in the Castle End. Albert Street, Short Street, which I did wonder whether is the same Short Street, but it must be. But despite being a very short street, seems to have a lot of resonances. Certainly number 2 Short Street is one of these sort of suspected houses. And again, I dare say I'm not really lowering the house price too much, but they're in these sort of places, Gold Street, Fitzroy, East Road, not so much in Mill Road. There are some cases, but they tend to be parents or aunts, you know, they're not sort of independent lodgers. So Short Street, I looked through my own records, and you know, Short Street appears as the residence for 86 different, as far as I can make them, different women in this period. And number 2 Short Street listed as the address for 16 different committed women. Now, it doesn't mean to say that 2 Short Street is a brothel, but the fact that it's cycling through different women, they're moving in and out, possibly some of these places are known by names, I'll get to this in a second if I have time, and they do seem to be sort of well-known houses of ill fare. Mill Road, not so much, East Road being much bigger and much more sort of transient in some ways. Again, lots of women there. Next one. I don't think I'll spend too much time on these, but it's possible to go to the census and find these. You know, for want of a better word, you could think of them as brothels. Mrs. Sheds turns up quite a lot. But if you were looking in the census, you wouldn't necessarily think, okay, that's a brothel. Here she is in 1516 Abbey Street, 1851. Charlotte Shed, head, living there with a 21-year-old son, who's a tailor, another son, who is a labourer, and a young boy, Charles Shed, who's a scholar. But with 2 lodgers, one of whom is Rosanna Calder, who is just described as a dressmaker. And Rosanna Calder is one of these women who turns up 30-odd times in the spinning house in a 5-year period. Her sister is almost certainly the other Calder, who's or Calder, who turns up in 1851. Anne Flack is sort of named as admits keeping a brothel in 1859, but this is some distance on. She's in the spinning house in the 1820s and early 1830s, but by the time you get to 1851, she seems to be keeping what the police think of as a brothel. Emma Flack, her niece, also committed in the spinning house some other convictions for assault, stealing, drunken disorder. Harriet Marsh, another woman who was in the spinning house, convictions for assault and threats. So, you know, that's what a brothel looks like, so to speak. It's a house of assignation, or maybe it's just a sort of slightly more organized lodging. You know, it's you have to sort of get rid of that Parisian idea of maison close and all the rest of it, and think that actually these women are in lodgings not so very different from lots of other places. But they do become known to the authorities. Same thing. So I'll just finish in order to sort of wearing you too much, but I'll just finish with three examples of women who represent something on this spectrum of it. One is a woman who called Rhoda Grant, born in 1818, something like that, in the village of Bourne, just outside of Cambridge. And Rhoda Grant takes the prize for me for being in and out of the spinning house the most, 70 times or so, over a career. In and out of the jail and the police court and the refuge and the spinning house, 70, 80 times. A kind of career on the streets, if you want to think of it like that, of nearly a quarter of a century. She's been in the county jail, and by the time you get to, well, I don't know, quite quickly, you must get to the point where the Victorians think of her, it's a fantastic Victorian word, they think of her, this is almost always women, I think, as an incorrigible. Such a sort of, you know, lots of utility for that word, but an incorrigible. Somebody who cannot be reached by normal reach. There's no deterrent for her. And I think they more or less end up not knowing what to do with her. But she turns up once in the Cambridge Female Refuge. It used to be on East Road, then moved to Newmarket Road, just opposite the church up there, Christchurch. But the way the Cambridge Female Refuge do it, they do it like a sort of interview. And it's hard to hear the voices of the women themselves, of course. But you get about as close here as you can, even if she's responding to what are clearly scripted questions. Age 30, can read, has lived in sin about 12 years. They may not be her words, you may be, how long have you lived in sin? 12 years. Feels the guilt of her sin. Do you feel the guilt of your sin, my dear? Born aboard, has been in a Sunday school, was seduced at Cambridge by a gownsman, felt frequent conviction of guilt when district visitors and others have called, has never been in extreme poverty, has continually walked the streets, is anxious to enter the house with a view to her eternal interests. Doesn't sound like her words. Has been in the habit of drinking, but otherwise is in good health, knows her ripples, has persuaded others to leave their course of life, I'm sorry, has a father and mother, poor and aged. So she looks like a professional. It's hard using these words, but if anyone is a professional, she looks like a professional. If we cycle on, you might contrast her to, and many of you will know the story of Emma Roth, the young girl who was murdered in 1876 by a Robert Browning, not the poet. Emma Roth, Rhoda Grant, I forgot the title, she's called a Barnwell celebrity, right, Cambridge Independent called that. Emma Roth, by contrast, is called an unfortunate girl. Only 15 when she was killed. And she was born in Cambridge, lived at New Street, and I don't know, just for added melancholy, you know, it's interesting to see the first time she appears captured by any records is at the age of 10 months, right at the bottom of this thing. 10 months old in the 1861 census. You know, next time, as it were, or the next instance you have of print is here she is buried in Mill Road Cemetery. The gravestone says 16 years, but she was 15 years old when she died. She seems to have left home. Her parents are living in Leaders Row, just off of Staffordshire Street. So all this is terribly local history. She left to live at a boarding house run by a Mrs. Phillips on 15 Crispin Street, which is described as a brothel. 2 weeks since leaving her parents' house, or her father's house, I can't remember, her mother's alive to me. Leaving the parents' house, 2 weeks later, she's plying her trade with another woman on Midsummer Common. And that's where she was killed by Robert Brown. It's a desperate awful, horrible story. It illustrates the obvious fact that sex work is an appalling and dangerous trade or profession or career, whatever we want to think about it. And she shouldn't stand in for every woman who participated in this prostitution economy, but she does represent something about it. She represents the danger, the violence, and I came across her gravestone just by accident. I knew she was in Mill Road Cemetery, but it didn't occur to me to ask anyone to look at the plot, see with her. So I was just walking through, and these amazing coincidences. She happens to be right by the side of the path, about sort of halfway between the Centre Circle and Norfolk Street, if you ever pass it. And there she is, Emma Roth, buried with mother and her brother. So, Rhoda Grant, a professional, a Barnwell celebrity, Emma Roth, an unfortunate girl. I'll move over. Apart from to say that in this is fantastically found by Cara in the Mill Road Cemetery team, this sort of broadside ballad, which manages to get, have they got her name right? I can't remember. Her name's right, but they managed to get his wrong. They managed to get the date wrong. That's broadside ballads for you, I guess. But she becomes narrated in the sense of victims, and she becomes a trope, really, rather than a real person. And Robert Browning did live, of course, he lived on Covent Garden. So the house doesn't exist anymore, but I don't know whether the house owner still has one of those marvellous blue plaques. I think they're amazing. But Robert Browning was a lodger there, I think. But this is a very local kind of geography. She lives on Leaders Road, just off Staffordshire Street, goes to Crispin Street, and the path of her killer, sort of ends up with Midsummer Common. So it's a Barnwell story, not a very comfortable one, but it's there. But finally, and just one last slide, just because Robin Mansfield is here, who mentions a great-great-great-great-grandmother, I think, I can't remember how many greats that is. But probably we should not let either Rhoda or Emma be sort of representative. Probably just women like Elizabeth Mansfield, who's described as a sort of an artful hypocrite she's good at sort of cadging stuff. I think she was called a sort of joking country girl. Anyway, born in West Wickham in 1831. But in 1849, was said to be recently living in a state of prostitution in Barnwell. She turns up in the census, domestic servant. I think it is probably her who is convicted for pickpocketing a few years later, stealing a handkerchief. She turns up on Wellington Street, which is not a good street, I hope that's clear, age 29. With her 10-year-old son, apparently, 10-year-old son called apparently James, married in 1869, and it's not so easy to trace the sort of fates of these women. And in the narrative, they should do the decent thing and chuck themselves in the river and sort of die of depravity and starvation and all this stuff. But like these are working women. They get married and move out of, this unrespectful profession. They do other things. Some of them fall on hard times. Perhaps some of them do a bit better for themselves. So I think I'd just end by, I've gone on too long, I'm sorry. I'll end by, stressing that often historians in the 19th century and social reformers always want to know what happened to these women that derailed them, that set them off on this path of sin. How did they fall into sin or throw themselves into sin? But they don't look, in the end, so very different from many, many, many other working women
were lodging in places like Barnwell, in the working class districts of the town, who appear in the census but don't have any sort of spectacular narrative about them. Asking the question why these women became prostitutes or sex workers is probably not the right question. You don't sort of ask why someone became a domestic servant or a janitor or something. There's a good sense in ending with somebody who's a little bit more ordinary than ending with a Rosa Grant, Barnwell celebrity, or somebody like Emma Rolfe, who's a classic and a terrible victim. So I'd like to end it there, really, that Barnwell is well known to quite many of us. It's also the name of an Emmanuel College undergraduate hostel. And it sort of stretches off in different directions. I think reasonably Mill Road and East Road could fall into that general East Cambridge. But I'll end there, and I hope I've said something about the sort of moral geography of Cambridge in the 19th century. Thank you for your attention. I'm sorry that most people couldn't see, or a lot of people couldn't see the slides. I'm perfectly happy to put it on a website as well. Okay.